let me discuss or open up today with a discussion on Freud's new introductory lectures. I hope you're able to get that book. I hope you're able to read at least the chapter on the dissection of the psychical personality. Now, I chose this lecture, meaning Freud's lecture, for a reason, that it is probably the most accessible to understand and grasp of his writings that capture his mature thinking. This is at a stage in his theoretical development where he is introducing to a professional audience in lecture format a synopsis of what psychoanalysis has captured in terms of our understanding of the individual within a social matrix. And like many German professors of his time, it was quite traditional that professors would prepare their lectures in a written form ahead of time and read it to the audience. And this was a convention that was just simply followed within academe. And because of that, they would attract a great deal of people interested in what the professor is going to be lecturing on. They would come. They would often come and sit and listen attentively and take notes of the lecture. Some would try to record it verbatim. So many of the great works, the great German thinkers, particularly German idealists such as Fichte and Hegel, would Schopenhauer would write their lectures. Husserl, who was also writing at the same time as Freud. So keep in mind that the audience is educated lay people as well, often residents in psychiatry, other physicians, as well as the intelligentsia that may have been invited to the talk. So just as a preliminary, why I want you to kind of think about this is that we often don't discuss the notion of the psyche anymore. We don't discuss the notion of soul. And what does that mean? I mean, when I use the term soul, I'm using it in the classical sense of what Freud meant. See, in German, soul, Seele, has no religious connotations to it whatsoever. It really is in reference to the psyche, which is from the Greek term, and that's a complex system. For instance, some might refer to it as mind, but mind doesn't really capture, that's more of an English sanitized word that is often equated with the brain or with cognition only, whereas it really comes from a more rich tradition. So the notion of the psyche or the soul goes back to the ancient Greeks, and they, in particular, let's say, starting with Plato, who starts to develop a theory of mind. We'll just use that as a sidebar, but a theory of human nature. Excuse me. This is connected to the notion that our inner sense of self, our inner worlds, are quite complex. So, for instance, the Greeks introduced the notion of desire. how are the passions that we seek out certain pleasurable activities or objects. They also introduce the notion of nous, or more of the rational faculty. And they also introduce the notion of ethics, of morality. So this is not necessarily a new idea, and this is what Freud is drawing upon, if you don't know the historical tradition which he would have been educated in. In fact, took philosophy with Franz Brentano when he was in university at the University of Vienna. And Brentano was teaching courses on Aristotle in particular. So Freud was exposed to this and yet wanted to fit it within a certain say quasi-scientific framework of his day. That means that he very much wanted to naturalize the psyche. He wanted to understand it in terms of naturalized processes, not supernatural processes. So what Freud introduces, though, is another dimension that is not discussed in the ancient world, and that is the notion that we can have a sense of self or an ego, or in German, an Ich, that we can have a sense of conscience and morality, what he refers to as the superego or the uber Ich, and the notion of desire or lust, that we have libidinous activity that structures our psyche. And so the ego, of course, is the rational faculty. It's the area where we have perception and cognition and representation of images. It controls the motor faculties. It also is the seat of goal-directed activities, so higher cognitive functions. But it also is an element of defensive purposes that are structured in the mind. So Freud starts out his essay talking about the ego. And how what that kind of means if we're to think of yourself. But even that's not a good term, because the self usually is simply a conscious identification with how you represent yourself to yourself. For Freud, he's making a portion of the ego unconscious. So there is a certain agency to mind that's operating outside of your immediate awareness. And we're going to get into details about that. But for the meantime, think about how you look at yourself. I mean, you start to now have representations of yourself, and whatever that might be, you know, whether it be the way you look, the way you feel inside, the way you construct your identity, the way you also form certain types of values. And so when Freud's introducing the notion of the ego here, he's also talking about how our inner self has a tendency to divide itself. In fact, it splits itself. We're a series of bifurcations in our mind. So there's so many different aspects of who we are. So you're going to be talking about or thinking about a certain portion of yourself that's this way, another that's this way, another that's this way, and how do we unify all those things? Well, we often don't. We often live in a succession of events or stages. in our minds, in our psyche. What I'm trying to juxtapose here is that you have a rich way of thinking about another human being that's in front of you in your practice, but you also have a very rich theory of mind or human nature or philosophy of culture that you can use to help try to orient yourself to a broader comprehension of the human being. Often we don't talk about that in today's antiseptic, scientized world. Psychology has become, has really devolved into, in many ways, a very reductive, crass paradigm of mind. I mean, if you see anybody on television, they will give you the same banal commentary about what causes something. It's in the brain. If I hear that again, I'm gonna bust my TV. It's like, come on, can't we come up with something a little bit more sophisticated than it's in the brain? We don't think of ourselves as a brain. I mean, I don't. I know that I have a brain, but you know, of course we're embodied, but we think to ourselves as I am a self. I have inner experiences, and there are multiple ones. So, for instance, we're sexual beings. We are aggressive beings. We are desirous beings. We are valueous beings. We have certain representations of ourselves that we strive toward. We have inner conflicts that we don't like to think about or don't want to even entertain. And all these complexities are transpiring within not only individual minds, but also within society. And they are all operative at once and on parallel levels or planes of functioning. And they, if you think about how complex this is, you think about how you have internal dialectics, meaning oppositional forces that are then in interaction with one another and then multiply their own complexities within themselves and then within a society. It is a quite a fascinating, perplexing riddle, but nevertheless, if you step back and think about it extrospectively or removed from your own first-person perspective and just try to see what patterns are, Freud has anticipated practically everything that we could use to explain the human condition. And I'll try to argue for that. For instance, before getting into certain details of the essay, Freud wants to highlight certain oppositions in the mind. So he introduces the notion of an ego that stands opposed to an unconscious, that stands opposed to a moral factor, that stands opposed, the moral factor even stands opposed to its radical opposition unconsciously, and yet there has to be a triangulation there. There has to be a mediation between all these events, and the poor ego is saddled with that that task. So there's internal conflicts because we can't have every wish and desire fulfilled. So on one level, you have basic drives, Triebe in German. We will translate that loosely to instincts, even though an instinct is technically not the same as a drive. An instinct is a very fixed, tropic, determined, you know, a factor that could be evolutionarily explained, whereas a drive is more like an urge or a compulsion. It's got plasticity and malleability to it, and it seeks out objects, and those objects that it seeks out are fluid. They are not determined in a real strict sense. So unlike we have an instinct to eat or drink, and we seek the object of eating and drinking, we don't necessarily have any control over turning that off. You know, there's no switch. You have to eat, you have to drink. That's what your biology is telling you. Whereas with a drive, you might say, I'd like to have it, but you can't. And you have an element of suppressing or repressing or denying. And so hence there's a great deal of fluidity there. So Freud, he wants to start with a foundation. And what's the great foundation? That Freud did not necessarily discover this, but he certainly gets credit for elucidating it in its full glory, and that's a theory of the unconscious. We must start with basic tenets or basic principles. So there are some people today that actually deny the existence of an unconscious. They feel that, you know, everything is consciousness. However, their argument fails in many ways, because when you start thinking, just even from a logical standpoint, from a logical point of view, we are not in full possession of understanding how our consciousness works. We're not aware of every single element of it. It usually speaks for us. Things speak for us. So we have to presuppose a priori, meaning prior to experience, certain structures or capacities that allow mental functioning. And it's very logical to assume that. I won't go into every argument, but it will become quite clear. So, however, people might also want to say, well, that's, you know, again, that's the deep features of the brain that are operating, and these things are operating in certain ways. Neuroscience is introducing all kinds of things that we would say that's unconscious. These are unconscious processes. They just simply want to localize them in certain regions or systems or loci of the brain. I don't want to negate that, by the way. Of course, we are embodied. Now, there are some who may want to think and propose the notion that you have a material body and an immaterial soul. And that's a form of dualism that comes from Plato. It was then recaptured and made famous by Descartes. And however, we don't have any good reason to believe that that's possible. How is it the mind and the body can be separate entities? There's so many logical contradictions with that. Not to mention philosophical conundrums that are very difficult to even address. At the same time, you cannot, what is something that's immaterial? It's more of an abstraction. It's something that I can contemplate, because everything that we experience is natural. We live in a naturalized world. We lived a naturalized body. But it doesn't mean that we have to boil everything down to our embodiment. I mean, our sense of self doesn't necessarily mean that I'm just like a series of, you know, neurotransmitters that are firing in the brain. Now, there are those that believe that's all there is, that everything just boils right down to a basic material stratum. Well, that's what Aristotle referred to as material causality, that what causes something is based upon what its physical properties or substrate is. Well, this is neuroscience today. Not, to be fair to neuroscience, not all neuroscience will believe that, because it's quite complex. However, there's other elements to this, that not only do we have an embodied psyche, that it's also based upon a series of events. And these events or processes that bring about certain events. So events bringing out more events is what Aristotle referred to as efficient causality. So, you know, we have to have both physical and efficient forces, because we are with, you know, we are embodied. But it doesn't mean that's all there is. So we also have complex systems that materialize. The neuroscience language refers to them as emergence. And the out of brain emerges a more complex pattern or structure or formal cause, as Aristotle would say. There's a form, a pattern. So for instance, our personalities are a good example of that. Now, often, you know, we can say, well, that's a really more complex thing. How does that emerge? How does this emergence then form and organize and take shape and then influence mental processes? Now, let's throw another thing in there. This is something that most people will deny, meaning most scientists will deny, the notion of freedom. Like, we have no free will and things like that, because we're already materialistically determined in our brain. Well, that doesn't seem to coalesce with my experience of myself. My experience of myself is that I have certain degrees of freedom. I can choose to make this type of tea here, or I can choose to have coffee. There are certain choices. There are certain agentic forces. Agency is a term for being able to choose, being able to have a certain array of repertoire of behaviors and actions and thoughts that one has some control over having. For Aristotle, we call this a final cause. And what that means is that there's a purpose or a goal or an aim. And when we have a purpose, a goal, and an aim that directs our behaviors or thoughts or feelings or desires, we have a very complex theory of causation. And this is, again, this was introduced by Aristotle. Whereas the very question of causation is being drawn into question in today's world. So, how does this all fit into Freud's theory of mind? Well, you can have unconscious intentions. You can have unconscious goals or aims or motives that are operating and you're not quite certain of them, or you're not quite aware of them. So when someone does something and you go, why would you have done that? When it's so like blatantly obvious that it was like dumb. You know that that action was gonna bring about some horrible thing. People can say, I don't know. I just got consumed by emotion. I just blurted the first thing that came out of my mouth, da 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 da. So we would say that there must be certain unconscious processes that are directing that, because they weren't, you weren't under control of your rational faculties. Yet people act this way all the time. People are in prison for a reason. They could not control themselves. So, what I thought I'd start out with is, again, this dialectic. So, what does Freud posit? He posits the notion of these, a dual class of drives. The things that we would say is evolutionarily informed, they do not contradict evolutionary biology in any way. That means we have unconscious forces that are largely motivated by sexual and aggressive proclivities. Now, this is just a basis. For instance, when we use the term sex and aggression, or in Freud's case, a death drive, or a sex drive, he's really talking about desire, and he's talking about aggression. But I'll get into some minor points about that later. I just want to highlight this. So when people say, oh, that's crazy, that's antiquated, everything boils down to sex for Freud. No, it doesn't. It's simply that was part of his early theory that he did insist upon, where the notion of libido theory was a central one for him, even though the way we define libido, or lust, is that it gets modified. It is really a life drive, and it gets modified in ways that we seek out certain types of other activities as manifestations of that original drive. And whereas aggression is its opposition. So in aggression, let's say initially as death, that has to be modified into a projection of itself into other objects or activities. And so aggression is in multiple ways. I mean, we see aggression all the time, verbal, emotional, but then also we see it in higher activities of mind, like right now. This could be considered, we're engaging in intellectual argumentation. And intellectual argumentation is a sublimation of aggression. When we are in competition with people in sports, and we have rivals, whereas we're competing with that person, we're envious of this person, these are all manifestations of aggression. They're just in higher forms or more refined forms. If we just were to take the thesis that what are the two things that drive human relations, I think it'd be very difficult to refute, but please do, if you can, I'd like to hear it. I'd like to hear the argument. I think it'd be difficult to refute that sex and aggression seem to structure our globe. What do you think of that thesis?
I agree with the sex. I disagree with the aggression part. I think the aggression is the byproduct of trying to, it's following the same thought process of sex. Sex is to procreate and to engender a new life and to create more of you, basically. The aggression is just a byproduct of trying to protect that. I don't think the aggression is like a direct thing that we're trying to do. It just happens to be trying to protect it.
But nevertheless, it is even if it's a byproduct, as you say, it is inseparable, because I mean, let's look at the world. I mean, when you have the Assad government, you know, killing its own people, you know, millions of people. When you have every single continent, except for Antarctica, in some form of warring toward its neighbor, these are palpable empirical facts.
I agree with that. I don't think the driving force is aggression. I would call it something else. I wouldn't call it aggression the driving force. I'd probably look for a higher word than that that causes the aggression. I don't know how to put it in a word, but I wouldn't.
Mm-hmm.
I disagree that aggression is like the force.
Okay.
Self-preservation. Basically.
Yes.
So self-preservation could be as a form of aggression, but it could also be a form of libidinous activity. We seek out things that sustain us. Okay, so we might see here a monistic theory of mind starting to develop from the way you're trying to dialogue with it. That aggression is a byproduct, is a modification of a basic instinct.
I just feel that it's missing the element of the cohesive or the harmony or working together, because to me the term aggression gives me the definition of conflict againstness, whereas as compared to one of the success of many communities is the collaboration, whether it's an organization or a society in terms of structural movement.
Very good. So what you're highlighting there is a tension in Freud's thinking. So he has to introduce a unification principle, a harmonizing principle. And so that's like when we have a split or we have a byproduct of this, we also have its opposite. And now that poor ego has to find a way of harmonizing these conflicts, because you can't have one over, you know, well, one can dominate another, but it leaves a residual conflict in the mind that seeks out compromises. So when we were discussing the notion of a compromise formation or a compromise function or symptom formation, let's say, is a good example of a compromise, even though a failed one, that poor psyche has to deal with all these competing wishes and conflicts and defenses and find ways of mediating it. You know, again, getting back to the notion that the notion of you're talking about biological basis of sexuality as being evolutionarily informed is something that I think just is beyond refute. However, whether that be in the animal world or in human beings, however, that can be negated in a human being. A human being has capacities for changing itself, but maybe not its nature. But the notion of, you know, of sexuality is so, again, ostensive. It structures our world in ways that we don't even often think, like such as, I want to have a mate. I want to secure, a partner. I want to have a family. I want to belong to a family. These are all interrelated, unless someone is denying. And many people people who are traumatized, who are abused, will deliberately not want to be in relationships, deliberately not want to have sexual partners because of the residue of their conflicts. And given that, given that the number one commodity on the internet is pornography throughout the entire world, again, another empirical indication that people are preoccupied with this. Given that we can't seem to have a harmonizing principle that operates, you know, throughout the whole planet, that within, I think within a month of Donald Trump being elected president, I think within the first 2 days or 3 days, we have Iran who shoots a ballistic missile, and it's worried about its a nuclear deal, followed by Kim Jong-un shooting a missile across the Sea of Japan, based on Netanyahu in Israel wanting to immediately start expanding its settlements. And actually, I was lecturing in Israel 2 weeks ago, and I was seeing this in the hotel room. Trump and Netanyahu was visiting Trump, and he makes some comment like, well, maybe there won't be a two-state solution. What's that mean? That means they're gonna invade Pakistan and take all their land. What silly thing to say. So everybody's getting all jumpity. We have Russia and the United States now with the Cold War again. It could be a tinderbox. It's not a pretty world, but yet we live here in Canada. Look at all these hate crimes that are coming out. It's as if people are given a fair, some kind of fair stage to just act out their racism, toppling over Jewish cemeteries bombing mosques and shooting people there in Canada. Recent thing at Concordia University when a student is emailing death threats to Muslim students. It's like, man, don't we have something better to do than having to hate the other? We need to have enemies. We need to find them. We will invent them. Why is that the case? Well, we have to look at a bigger, theory of mind. Yes?
Maybe this is on the same line of thinking, but I'm just wondering for clarification purposes. Why is aggression referred to as the death drive? Is it because sex is kind of protecting our life by seeking out things that can help us flourish, whereas aggression is helping protect us from death? So keeping us from things that are
going to
destroy us?
Well, that's a good question. It's complex, too. Jumping ahead here, Freud had a difficulty trying to reconcile aggression or death with life. How is it that these processes that can operate together? In fact, in Beyond the Pleasure Principle is where he concluded that we have a death drive. And the death drive, in many ways, is the foundation of the psyche. The psyche wants to be in a permanent state of bliss. It wants to be in a state where there is no tension, a tensionless state. And this notion of tensionless is a very unconscious process. However, it is disrupted by life. I mean, it's encroached upon by other things, and it must now deflect itself. And so hence, we could say that life comes from death. And yet, at the same time, it could be considered as complementary forces of the same drive. So aggression is a displacement. It is a modification of its earlier form. It doesn't want to die because it invents, a libidinal activity. Or it wants to secure its own death through circuitous fashions in its own way. So this is complex. However, the notion is one of compatibility, that we desire, and what we desire are many things. We desire life and we desire death, and hence a basic dialectical friction that exists in the mind. Now, some people, when I say death, we desire death, not necessarily consciously, but keep in mind, at some point in someone's life, they may seriously entertain suicide. They may think about it. The mere fact that you would think about it alerts us to conflict in the psyche. And so that, Freud would try to normalize that, meaning it's, these are psychic processes. People get overwhelmed. And that's why they develop certain types of neuroses. Some people's neuroses are going to be more anxiety oriented. Some are going to be more obsessionally oriented. Others are going to be more acting out of an impulse oriented. It's just a matter of degree, and it's a matter of how that unique psychic configuration organizes itself. So, in many ways, aggression is an earlier modification, to get back to your question. Now, some people, they express their aggression entirely differently than others. So, to use just a stereotype example, you know, men are more confrontational, direct, They're more physically aggressive, physically dominating. And then they get into rivals with fellow men or boys or whatever, and they get into, just flagrant aggressive conflicts. Women may be more inclined to be more verbally, aggressive or verbally argumentative rather than physically. But I don't want to, you know, push the stereotype that far, because of course we see that there's no bounds when it comes to how people express both their, you know, desires as well as their aggressions. For instance, love is it's a manifestation of libido. It's a manifestation of an instinctual process. So is hate. In fact, Freud says you can't have one without the other on some level, because I think it would be very difficult for a human being to actually authentically say they've never had any hate. Well, I guess that means a different thing to different people, but when you get overwhelmed by something emotionally and you have an obstacle in front of you, this is a good example of the death drive. It's like, I just wish you would vanish. Gone. You're poof. You are immediately confronted with, this person stands in opposition to me and my feelings, my desire, and I wish they were dead. I wish they were gone. But you don't really want them dead. That would be horrible. So now you have this superego that comes in and says, God, what an awful human being you are. You see there's this notion that you should really be punished for thinking that way. That's bad. That's immoral. And then if you throw a religious factor in it, you know, that's something that you can go to hell for. You then bring up all kinds of competing things that are going on. And then that ego has to say, okay, wait a minute. That's too extreme, both sides. Let's see if we can mediate this. Let's see if we can just calm that down. And this could be operative on such an unconscious level that one doesn't really understand how this all transpires in a fraction of a second. What Freud, with that preliminary, Freud then introduces other bifurcations, other dialectical processes. The ego is now in opposition to the superego. So that superego is our moral agency, and it's strict. And not only is it strict, but it harnesses the death drive. It wishes to to punish people. Look at our system of law. Perfect example of a harsh superego. It says we should punish people. They should be put in jail, and in some places there should be state execution where we put people to death. That's a social democratic structure that is institutionalized in our legal system. And yet we're supposed to be a sophisticated society where we put people to death. But that's a conflict in itself. There are certain people that say, well, they're bad people, they've hurt people, they've killed people, they should be put to death. They should not be here. We need to protect the rest of society. You have other people say, well, that's not the moral thing to do. That's not our better nature. The angels of our better nature. So even that is a conflict. How do we mediate that? Well, then the ego says, well, maybe we can just lock them up. We don't have to kill them, just lock them up. Feed them. I'm being facetious. But simplifying matters here. You've got this going on. Internal splits, how do they get resolved? That's not easy. Because it presupposes that there can be some overall notion of no conflict. Everything gets resolved. But then that seems to violate the fact that we're always seeking something else. We're always experiencing a desire for something else. Like, I don't know about you, but when you achieve a goal, you might go, yay, great, I got what I wanted, da da da. But then it might be also anticlimactic. You know, all right, I didn't think it was going to be what I thought it was going to be. Now what? What's next? But that seems to be the mind. The mind wants something else. So, and we have certain fantasies. The fantasies, let's say, of peace. Well, I guess it would be nice to have a modicum of peace, and let's hope that you have it in your own family. But most of the time, people who come to see us do not have internal peace. And you'll rapidly see that the nature of their conflicts stem from their family. Not always, but put it this way, I don't believe I've ever met a patient in my over 25 years of treating people who haven't had a problem with some family member or some significant other that have caused some problems for them, even if it's minimized. Maybe some practitioners have. I don't know. Freud starts out by saying the whole theory of psychoanalysis is built upon the perception of the resistance offered to us by the patient when we attempt to make his unconscious conscious to him. When you point things out to somebody that they might not be aware of, there's an instant defensiveness. People aren't ready to accept a certain type of truth. And that's what Freud and the early founders of psychoanalytic practice, in basically this is the foundation of psychotherapy. So I'm gonna use that term interchangeably. That psychotherapy is construed differently today. This was the only game in town back in those days. People were experimenting with certain methods. They were developing a theory of mind to explain why people acted or functioned the way they did. And what Freud had observed clinically, empirically, is that people are engaging in certain resistances to interventions. The first thing you're going to encounter when you get out and practice is, let's say you tell somebody what to do. I hope you don't do that. But there are certain methodologies to say, yeah, you here's what you do. You teach the patient to do this. You give them certain techniques. You have a certain script. You even have some psychotherapies that are so manualized that they'll have a manual right there. This is what you should do next. Do this, do that. Here's some homework. Go home, let's have a journal. You know, you can journal and think about your experiences. Da 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 da. Once you go practice your mindfulness, da 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 da. And then when they come back, you find out they didn't do it. Well, because they're resisting, because they don't want to do it, because they think it's stupid, because they feel belittled. They feel like they're in kindergarten. You tell them, get them some homework, go home and do. But other people may want that. They may want you to be the expert, to give them things. In that situation, you have a transference to you. You're the healer. You're the therapist. You're the person who is going to help me. And then that is another unconscious dynamic that's manifesting. So you'll have either resistance, or you'll have, let's say a certain positive transference to you. You could also have a negative transference, especially when you get people who have more traumatized personalities. They are looking, dissecting everything about your face, the way you look, what you say next. Are you attuned to them? And they're just ready to pounce. Their aggressive inclinations are already, on the prowl. So starting with the notion of resistance, very important. Like, because people are by nature going to be this way, your approach has to be very sensitive to how you want to get inside their little world. How are you going to get inside their head, in their lives? How are you going to be received? Often, I will adopt the stance that I feel that the patient needs in order for me just to form any kind of connection, any kind of rapport. And so one of the last things is for me to start foisting things on them that they're not ready to either hear or accept or explore. These are things that slowly, once they feel that you're on their side, that you are non-threatening, that they can trust you, that you're not going to pass judgment on them, that they feel that you've understood their inner experience, that's when they're going to be more likely to hear aspects of themselves that they would resist hearing. So Freud says that we started from our clinical work trying to understand why would these resistances arise, and hence he starts to then formulate a theory that there is an unconscious agency, where even though some people even consciously would say, yes, okay, I'll do that, or that's a good idea, and yet there's something inside that mitigates against that. It's doesn't allow it. That is the unconscious aspect of the ego that's resisting the very process. In fact, a symptom can be viewed as a refusal to want to be given up. A person wants to hold on to their pathology. As Lacan or Zizek would say about Lacan, is that they enjoy their symptoms too much. Like, what would it be like for you not to be this way? it'd be like, well, God, you know, I've always been a depressive. I don't know what it'd be like not to be a depressive. You know, they're thinking like, what would my life be like if I didn't feel this way? Sometimes there's radical resistance to change. People really don't want to change. Deep down, they want to stay the way they are. They want the world to change. So Freud introduces other aspects in his theory. He introduces the notion of a pleasure principle and a reality principle. So you've got life and death, sex and aggression. You've got the ego, the superego. Of course, the drives or the instincts and the contents of our repressions and defenses are unconscious, by and large. Now he introduces other things that are going on. He's introducing, well, what's motivating people in their actions? So one motivation is to seek pleasure, seek satisfaction, seek gratification of desire. And this is what we see in children. They don't have a developed superego. That's a developmental achievement. The superego is not something that exists at birth. You're not born, an infant isn't born with a conscience. It is, cultivated. It's cultivated through our identifications with our parents and other significant figures in our life and our immediate communities. Were taught in school or other social or religious institutions. So the child who sees a candy and reaches and grabs it in the store is just simply being natural. It's only through the introduction of the reality principle that we introduce in the ego, in the psyche, a negation. No. What is the first thing that parents say to their kids besides lovey-dovey things? They say no. Very powerful word. The introduction of negation. No signifies a not, an absence, a prohibition. And hence we have to internalize that. We say to ourselves, you know, I'd like to have that, but I can't have it. For a variety of reasons, I can't have it. So just control your impulses, control your desires. That's the development of not just the superego, but the ego itself. So reality presents itself to us. You have to obey. And if you don't obey natural laws, there will be natural consequences. So when my patient wants to drive this tractor trailer through the ING branch in Ajax and had stalked the patient or stalked the center there and decided that 10:30 was the most optimal time to drive that tractor trailer through because that's the smoke break and most of the staff were outside smoking, that he could just plow right into it. And when I just introduced the reality principle that you're going to get arrested, it's like he gets paranoid. I said, you'll be immediately arrested. What are you going to do? You're going to go to jail, prison at your age? You know, and so it's like it helped him kind of contain things because his fantasies had gotten out of the way. He's so enraged about how they mistreated him. I find the reality principle is important to remind people of certain consequences of actions. And sometimes that's helpful, but it helps them get a ground on things. When suicidal patients present themselves in crisis, they often cannot think that there will be another moment this is so unbearable, so in such psychic pain in this moment. They forget that there's this thing called time, and that this is merely a moment, and it will pass. It might not seem like it will right now, but it will. And often that helps. They just need to get through this moment. Reminding them of how the world works. Yeah.
If you had a suicidal patient and you kind of wanted to use this reality principle to tell them, like, all the people that they would leave behind and how they would feel, like the fact that there'd be consequences to them taking action, would that help them kind of dissolve that fantasy, or would it just make it worse because you'd be introducing this sense of guilt to them?
Well,
or would that be like patient specific?
It's a good question. It's really a technical question. On one hand, you're right. You know, of course, that they would be hurting other people that love them, mm-hmm. or that they even love themselves. But often, people in that state of mind aren't really reflecting about other people. They, in fact, other people really don't matter. And that's what's the hardest part, getting them to reconnect, reform a mental attachment to the people that they need. But often that they're hurting so bad is due to others, due to loss, due to abuses, not feeling loved. I don't appeal to that kind of reason often. That comes later. In the moment of the crisis, is that you want them to get all their thoughts out on the table. Just like the man that I showed you in the video, you unpack it, allow them to voice their thoughts, because voicing it, articulating it, gets it out of their head. When it's just contained in one's mind, it's unbearable at times. So giving them permission to talk about everything that they're thinking and wanting to do often puts the ground under them. But anyway, that's a technical question, and I guess it really does matter in the moment where people are at. So as I'm just meandering through some of these sections, I'm just trying to distill this, the gist of Freud's complex theories. If the nature of saying no, putting restraints on impulses, is essential to the psyche, which it is, it's going to lead to another series of defenses. So we have to deny stuff. No, negation is denial. It doesn't exist. So when I was introducing the notion of defenses last time, so people will deny basic things. It doesn't exist, never happened, I don't think about it. And this is part of their defenses. Now, you could point this out, that this does exist, or this is not going to go away, in a way that they can metabolize it. So we can, let's start looking at that together. I know that you're often at times feel that, that you're not thinking this. And that's why when Freud wrote a paper, a seminal paper on negation, or that saying no, denial, is the most basic of all defenses, because it protects us from perceiving a reality that we wish did not exist, so we deny it. So people deny problems. They don't see that they have problems, or they don't see what they do is causing problems for others. It's always the other's problem. So when people get their backs up, when they get overly defensive about something, we're seeing the mind at work. And we're also alerted to how do we want to handle the person's resistance here. They're awfully touchy about this, and for a reason. Obviously, they're very sensitive about a certain type of emotional truth that they don't want to accept or face or look at. When somebody spontaneously denies something, this is where you can see that negation or is operative unconsciously. So when someone they're talking about whatever they are talking about in therapy, and you ask them, what do you think that's about? And they say, well, it has nothing to do with my mother. That would be a spontaneous kind of form of negation. So alert the clinician to, there's something going on about mom back there. So we best pay attention to this, because it's a telegraph of a conflict. How do we get to it is another question. First, being alert to it is important here. All these other types of defenses that are bound up in basics is splitting. So when you have a denial, you have also a splitting that takes place, and hence that's another bifurcation. And the splitting is tucking away this piece of unsavory knowledge because it's too difficult to look at. And let's say it's compartmentalized. Might be denied, might be forgotten, hence repressed. Or it might be just sitting there in incubation, festering, until that unconscious ego decides, I'm going to project that onto some object. You're the bad person. I don't like this. You're bad. And that's a projection. Of course, we're not consciously saying to ourselves, you know what? I need to have an emotional whipping boy. Who's around? Oh, that person. That will do good. Gene. No, we just do it. And at the same time, it's a transference phenomenon. I don't like the way that person looks. I don't like their face. And I'm going to have negative thoughts directed toward that face. Even though that face, I don't know that person, I don't know that face, they haven't done anything to me. However it speaks. And if you're honest with yourself, you will be aware of passing judgment on human beings every day, just based upon transferences. So, however, there's a difference between having a transference projection and acting on it, such as, that's somebody I hate and I'm going to go into that mosque and open fire. Now that's entirely different situation. That's why this is where the conscience and the rational faculty of the ego that says you have to delay gratification, you have to say no, is not really operative. Yet this is what's happening all over the world. People are killing one another, slaughtering one another, in the name of a value, in the name of an ideal, of all things. The superego says, my truth, my ideal, my values are superior to yours, and not only that, you're a threat to me and my values, so you should be eliminated. You should be shot, blown up, disenfranchised as a group, as a nation. It's, again, it's very difficult to dismiss these dynamics on a mass scale. even though we don't necessarily want to reduce it only to this. Freud wants to talk about various types of unconsciousness. He wants to talk about a descriptive unconscious, so to speak, and that's to help us, get a better idea of what's going on. He also wants to talk about a dynamic unconscious, meaning that there's all these tempestuous forces that are at work, and once again, the ego has to mediate all those different forces. He talks about a topographical model, which is using depth metaphors, so where you have various layers to the psyche, or various depths. So you have a conscious, a preconscious, and an unconscious, so to speak. Unconscious, we don't know it in itself. He was very much a Kantian in that way, that we can't know the unconscious directly, only how it manifests. And there is an intermediary space, I think a psychic space is a good way of describing it, that he would call preconscious, meaning that we're not necessarily aware of it in the moment, but if your attention was drawn to it, you could become aware of it, such as you sitting in your seat right now, you becoming aware of your body. And then we have consciousness, which is complex, it as we know it. It's interesting, getting back to the mind-body problem, why I'm thinking about it. For neuroscientists, to boil everything down to the brain, and they're using functional MRIs and CAT scans, and they're showing colorful little places in the brain that are lit up with this and this when the mind does this or that. That's not consciousness. That's a method for looking at the brain. You don't see consciousness there. It's an absolute category mistake. You don't experience your brain. You experience consciousness. You experience your inner lived experience, or what we call qualia. Various thoughts, desires, feelings. That's what you are experiencing. You're not experiencing this MRI slide. And as Aristotle would say, to conflate the whole with the sum of its parts is a mirological fallacy, meaning that a part in the brain isn't the whole thing. What Alfred North Whitehead referred to as a fallacy of simple location or misplaced concreteness, that agency isn't like a particle in the brain. So it might help us to understand, maybe, and this is even a stretch, the neurobiology of the functions of the brain, just as having any form of knowledge, but does that really help you as a clinician when people are really experiencing internal mental states? So this is what a psychoanalytic point of view has to offer. Freud is also talking about the notion of an economic aspect to the psyche, and that is, what is its most simplest functions? And so hence, when he introduces the pleasure pain principle, when he introduces notions of defense that are about protecting the self, that are about a variety of different things that have to do with mediating internal dangers. This is why he comes up with this tripartite system, that's famously known as the id-ego-superego. And at this point, there are many different aspects that we could focus upon in terms of these internal conflicts that develop because of these three different systems. You might think of them not really as three separate systems or agencies or entities, but for concrete purposes, it may help. When in reality, they all stand in relation to one another. They're just modifications. They're modifications of earlier structures. So our moral sense is to be seen in a higher caliber, in a more exalted dimension of the psyche. And we can see that this is what all societies strive for. They strive to have a certain ethics. They have values and ideal standards and practices that structure, even when it comes to domestic relations in the family, with other people. These are all guiding systems of values that are taken up, but they're taken up differently in different groups and nations and states and ethnicities and cultures. It's just, how does it get played out? The Western mind is many times is overly rationalized, that we put a great deal of emphasis on science and reason and logic. And while that's fine and dandy and true, we also have to keep in mind that we're largely emotionally driven creatures. And so we have feelings, we have intuitions, we have internal desires and wishes, and that drives a large part of our societies. Just think of all the things that you are fantasizing about every day when you're on your internet or on the TV. You're constantly being bombarded with things that people want you to buy. And you're probably just passively not even aware of it, but you might make certain mental notes of it, and then you're out in the store and all of a sudden, okay, well, let's try that product. And you might not even know why, but you've already been conditioned unconsciously to want to buy it because you've identified with something in it. And that identification may be anything from a beauty product that women want to have to put on their face, to a certain type of food or a beverage or clothing line. And you've just been unconsciously influenced by an external agent. So how do you make sense out of that? Well, it was actually Freud's, I think, nephew of his wife, Bernays, who went on to use Freud's theory to develop a whole industry of marketing. And this is what we have today as the outcome, based upon manipulating the masses' unconscious desires. And it works. So let me try to sum up the lecture. There's always some aspect of our desire that is a remainder in the unconscious. Because desires or wishes can never be fully fulfilled, only sated, only temporarily gratified. So in many ways, while a drive can find an object and get satisfaction, desire in itself is, it's never satisfied. Because it's a driving force in the psyche. It's always seeking, it's always pining and wanting new objects. There are certain aspects of our desire that are always going to be alienated from us, and there will be other aspects that we will become aware of. And yet, these forces are also split internally and unconsciously at war with one another. So you've got, let's say, a portion of yourself that has certain primitive fantasies, and another portion of yourself that's condemning you for having them, or chiding you in some fashion. And this creates tension. How is it that we can be split and divided in this way? Yet those aspects of our desires and our defenses want fulfillment, and hence, once again, finding compromises is often what happens. But Freud says that we are warned by a proverb against serving two masters at the same time. The poor ego has things even worse. It serves three severe masters and does what it can to bring their claims and demands into harmony with one another. These claims are always divergent and often seem incompatible. No wonder that the ego so often fails in its task. The three tyrannical masters are the external world, the superego, and the id. When we follow the ego's efforts to satisfy them simultaneously, or rather to obey them simultaneously, we cannot feel any regret at having personified this ego and having set it up as a separate organism. It seems hemmed in on all three sides, threatened by three kinds of danger, to which, if it is hard pressed, it reacts by generating anxiety. So, this is Freud's notion of the signal theory of anxiety. You are immediately alerted to a danger. Your psyche responds with nervousness. It has to be alerted to mediating those dangers. Freud goes on to say that the ego, driven by the id, is confined by the superego, repulsed by reality, struggles to master its economic task of bringing about harmony among the forces and influences working in and upon it. And we can understand how it is so often that we cannot suppress a cry. Life is not easy. In the end, Freud goes on to say, its intention is to strengthen the ego, to make it more independent of the superego, to widen its field of perception and enlarge its organization so that it can appropriate fresh portions of the id, or the it. And this is where he introduces his famous phrase, where id was, there shall ego be. However, it's not really the right translation. Voest var solic verden means where it was, there I shall become. So what is he saying? He's saying that the notion is that we need to become aware of these unconscious processes in us, and that we don't want to be dominated by our more crude natures. And the more conscious we become of our unconscious, the more you feel that you're becoming a person. And the more control you have over certain aspects of your psyche that are less regulated. So he places a great deal of focus on becoming aware, having insight into your depths and to your conflicts, and finding ways of binding tensions, finding solutions, of unifying conflicts, of trying to maximize some form of harmony, even though it's something that will always be incomplete. It will always be a process of change and becoming. Yet, this is no different than the early philosophers who valued insight and knowledge and truth and wisdom over the more irrational aspects of the passions or instincts. Okay, that in a nutshell is Freud's thesis.